فعاش القلب إخلاصا وصرت تحومك الطير تحلق في ثقافات وتنهل من ربى الخير.
الحمد لله، نحمده ونستعينه ونستهديه، ونعوذ بالله من شرور أنفسنا ومن سيئات أعمالنا، من يهده الله فلا مضل له، ومن يضلله فلا هادي له. وأشهد أن لا إله إلا الله وحده لا شريك له، وأشهد أن محمدًا عبده ورسوله وصفيه وخليله وخيرته من خلقه، صلوات ربي وسلامه عليه وعلى الآل والصحب الكرام. أما بعد، فاتقوا الله عباد الله، واتقوا يومًا ترجعون فيه إلى الله، ثم توفى كل نفس ما كسبت وهم لا يظلمون. قال الله تبارك وتعالى: يا أيها الناس، إنا خلقناكم من ذكر وأنثى وجعلناكم شعوبا وقبائل لتعارفوا إن أكرمكم عند الله أتقاكم. My beloved brothers and sisters in Islam, it is our first duty to remind one another to be conscious of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. It is something known as taqwa, something known as the consciousness of Allah. Some translate it as the fear of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, the knowledge that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is the creator, maker, nourisher, cherisher, sustainer, provider, protector, curer. At all times we need to understand and realize this. We need to be conscious of the fact that we are returning to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. If we are conscious of the fact that we are returning to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, we will become better people. We will become people who fulfill the plan of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala as His wish. The Creator, He is the one who decides how whom He created shall operate on earth. And this is why, my brothers and sisters, the verse that I read before you just now is very closely connected to the creation of mankind and its purpose. In Surah Al-Mulk, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala tells us, الَّذِي خَلَقَ الْمَوْتَ وَالْحَيَاةَ لِيَبْلُوَكُمْ أَيُّكُمْ أَحْسَنُ عَمَلًا وَهُوَ الْعَزِيزُ الْغَفُورُ. It is He, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, who created death and life in order to test you, who from amongst you has better deeds. Which means I need to try and have better deeds. You need to try and have better deeds. And we need to try and become better as the days pass and not worse. In order to understand this, the verse of Surah Al-Hujurat, Ya Ayyuhan Nas, O people, O people, imagine Allah is addressing all people, not just the Muslims. But in fact, Allah says, O people. Why? Because the people were created by Allah. The one who created the Muslims is the one who created the non-Muslims, is the one who created all the other creatures that we see around us. Everything was created by Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. That Allah is telling us, O people. The message of the Quran is not just for the Muslimin, but it is for entire mankind, for humanity, man and jinn. They will receive the message of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. It is what they do with that message that will distinguish them from one another. But it is Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala who will judge ultimately between the people and will judge them based on His own divine justice. So this beautiful address is to all mankind. Remember, Islam does not belong to me, nor does it belong to you as ownership, but it belongs to us as belief. We believe and we are convinced, we are actually believers within our hearts, in our actions, in our tongues, the way we operate, the way we live. We believe in Allah, but it is not sole ownership to us. What that means is No one can come forth and say Islam is just an Arab religion, Islam is just an Indian religion, Islam is just a Malay religion, etc. No, Islam is for all. It is for all in the sense that that message is totally and absolutely universal. The question is, why did Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, being so powerful, create people who did not accept that message of the deen? Yet he is able to actually have everyone on the deen. While Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, وَلَوْ شَاءَ رَبُّكَ لَآمَنَ مَنْ فِي الْأَرْضِ كُلُّهُمْ جَمِيعًا أَفَأَنْتَ تُكْرِهُ النَّاسَ حَتَّى يَكُونُوا مُؤْمِنِينَ. If Allah willed, He could have had all mankind, every one of them, be believers in Allah. If He wanted, He could have had that. He could have done it. Allah says, you don't force the people to enter into the fold of belief. No one can compel another to become a believer or to believe. No one can force. So what is my duty? My duty is to convey the message in a very respectful way. Look at Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. How did he convey the message? I ask you, by Allah, did he swear anyone in order to convey the message? Did he insult someone in order to convey the message? We are talking of the mushrikeen of Mecca. Did the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam swear them? Did he insult them? Did he call them names? Yet they were harming him. They were trying to harm him. That harm, obviously, Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, being the best of creation, the most noble of all prophets, the most dear unto Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, the most perfect from all of the creation of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, none can harm him. None can reach him with their insults. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says to us in such a beautiful way while addressing Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, إِنَّا كَفَيْنَاكَ الْمُسْتَهْزِئِينَ. We have indeed protected you completely and totally from those who try and mock at you. Have you not noticed that every time someone tries to mock at Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, In fact, that very mockery results in more people accepting the fold of Islam. More people entering the fold of Islam. It is through their mockery, when they think they are creating a mockery, in actual fact, they can never be doing that. No matter what they do, it is only awareness. Their intentions will be against them, but it will not harm Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. He is the perfect. He is the one who is the most loved by Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. No ways can anyone's statements ever insult Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. In fact, they would be insulting themselves. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala protect us. So Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala shows us the blessed path of the messenger, the most calm sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, the most humble sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, the most eloquent sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, the most highly educated sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, the example to follow sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. When Allah shows this to us, He shows us that no matter what the people of Makkah did, He never swore them. When they swore him, he did not swear back. When they tried to harm him, he did not harm back. When they tried all their shenanigans, he did not return it with something similar if it was negative. Rather, he kept on doing good. He kept on ignoring their insults. He kept on praying for them. He kept on smiling with them. He kept on trying with them until a day came. You and I know that there was the victory of Makkah. Subhanallah. Look at the people of Ta'if. What did Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam do? When the angels came to him and told him, we can destroy these people, it was very simple for him to just nod his head. But he was the messenger of mercy. وما أرسلناك إلا رحمة للعالمين. O Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, we have not sent you except as a mercy for all the creations, for all the worlds. You are a point of mercy. Your followers are supposed to be merciful amongst one another. They are supposed to reach out to others in a way that you taught them, sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. So my brothers and sisters, we need to go back to this original teaching of Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. We need to stop insulting one another. We need to stop spreading hate against one another. We need to stop enmity against one another. If we do not do that, we will start fighting one another, killing one another, destroying one another, as we are witnessing across the globe. We are seeing the problem. We can see what is happening. What lesson do we learn from it? Let's be honest. This is a straight talk. We need to make sure that the heart is protected from hate. In fact, when someone else spews hate, we need to think positively of how to resolve the problem, because hate plus hate does not make love. In fact, it makes more hate, enmity, fighting and killing. And that is not the plan of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. One might argue that there were wars fought by Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. I want to tell you that right at the end, there was something known as the victory of Makkah, which was the best example that we could follow. What was it? When the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam entered Makkatul Mukarrama with all his companions, and they were beyond 100,000. Do you know what happened? He was very powerful. They could see the numbers alone. They could see the power of this beautiful deen that had now come back to Makkatul Mukarrama. And do you know what happened? He gathered the people of Quraysh and he asked them a simple question. And this goes to show you the mercy of Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. He says, Ya ma'shara Quraysh, ماذا تظنون أني فاعل بكم? O people of Quraysh, what do you really think I'm going to do with you today? Imagine the enemy. Not just those who spewed hate from their mouths. Those who fought with weapons against Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam and his most blessed companions, Abu Bakr as-Siddiq radiyallahu anhu, Umar al-Faruq radiyallahu anhu, Uthman dhin-Nurayn radiyallahu anhu, Ali ibn Abi Talibin radiyallahu anhu, and the others. They were fought against by these people whom the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam was now addressing on this blessed occasion of the victory of Makkah. And he's asking them a question, what do you think I'm going to do to you? Imagine someone harmed you for so long, so many years. They said so much, they harmed you, they caused loss, they did so much of negativity. Look at how positive the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam was. They looked at him. They had no option but to hope in goodness. Now, when you see that this man is so powerful, he can actually execute all of us. Or he can punish us, jail us, whatever he wants to do, he can do. He can decide to whip every one of us because he is the powerful on this day. Subhanallah. That is when the true quality of mercy, the true quality of love, the true quality of positivity definitely shows. He says, اذهبوا فأنتم الطلقاء. He says, go, all of you, you are free today. There will be no retribution. I tell you today what the Prophet Yusuf alayhi salam told his brothers, لا تثريب عليكم اليوم. There will be no retribution against you today. Guess what? These people were not yet Muslim. Do you know that? The bulk of them were not yet Muslim. When he forgave them, they were not yet Muslim, most of them. And what happened as a result of that beautiful gesture of his, as a result of that forgiveness wholesale, as a result of the positivity, as a result of the mercy, as a result of the goodness and kindness of the most blessed of creation, sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, most of them accepted Islam. Most of them turned. Where are we? What do we do today? The religious from amongst us sometimes spew hatred against those they differ with in certain matters. Why? My brothers, my sisters, is that the way of Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam? Is that really the way? Is that the way to spew hate? To spew that which will create dissent, disunity, dissatisfaction, fighting, killing, enmity, etc. You have a difference. Discuss it with respect. Sometimes you will not be able to solve the matter. Don't worry. Leave it to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Don't we have differences amongst us as the Muslim Ummah? Don't you think it is more important for us to be merciful amongst those who say the Shahada, yet we are being taught to be merciful even to those who do not say the Shahada by virtue of one of the examples, that is this victory of Makkah that I mentioned moments ago? So if Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala and the Messenger sallallahu alayhi wa sallam are teaching you and I to be kind and merciful to those who don't believe, what do you think is your duty to those who say the Shahada? And notice I'm uttering these words for a reason. People say the Shahada, but sometimes we say they're not Muslims. Who are we to say that? Don't you think it's unfair to say that? Don't you think it's unrealistic to say that? When the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam says, "Man qala la ilaha illallah dakhala al-jannah." Whoever utters the Shahada shall enter Jannah. And obviously the complete shahada is la ilaha illallah Muhammadur Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. They shall enter Jannah. Imagine the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam tells his uncle Abu Talib on his deathbed. He says, "Ya ammi, qul kalimatan uhajju laka biha yawm al-qiyamah." Oh my uncle, I want you to utter. What is it? It's an utterance. It is an utterance. I want you to say, la ilaha illallah. I want you to say the statement, kalimatan. What is the statement? La ilaha illallah Muhammadur Rasulullah. I want you to say the statement and I will fight your case on the day of judgment. Subhanallah. Don't you think if any one of us have uttered that statement, the same would apply to us? We receive the intercession of the most blessed and the most loved unto Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. That's what we're looking forward to. May Allah grant us the intercession of Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. Say ameen. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala bless every one of us. My brothers and sisters, this is the pure teaching of Rasulullah. It was a teaching of love, of kindness. When the Christians speak, they say that Jesus taught love and kindness. We agree with that. We believe in Jesus. We believe he was a messenger of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. He indeed taught love, forgiveness and kindness and the worship of Allah alone. And we also believe that Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam went even beyond that. And he taught us how to free ourselves and that he will be the owner of an intercession on the day of judgment by the will of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And we are looking forward towards that. Therefore, spread love and don't spread hate. Spread love, that is your religion. Don't spread hate. I promise you, if someone is trying to make you hate another, then indeed they are making you head in the wrong direction. We might hate a deed, for example, a drunkard who is drinking. We don't like the habit of that drinking, but the person, he may be our brother. In fact, he is our brother, minimum in humanity, sometimes even in faith, but he is committing a sin. Therefore, with love, we will try and correct him. With love, we will try and reach out to him. No one knows when that will work, how that will work. My brothers and sisters, how many of us know of young people who had very bad habits? After some time, they quit their bad habits by the help of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, by the dua of a parent perhaps, by the dua of someone of the community, perhaps a pious person, a saint, etc. Perhaps a dua of anyone who may have prayed for them. Perhaps somehow, somewhere, they left their bad ways and habits. Imagine if we had written them off earlier on, what would have happened? How many of us know of pious people? In fact, how many of us seated here right now have had bad habits that we have quit? Therefore, spread love. Correct people with care. Be careful, the ummah is fragile. Don't destroy it. When you have an egg in your hand, you are expecting to benefit from the egg, but you need to be very careful. It is fragile. Small movement and it is cracked. Small movement and it is destroyed. We need to make sure that we love one another even more than this. This is why, like I say, we have to keep reminding each other. When the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam addressed the kuffar of Mecca, the mushrikeen of Mecca, who were circumambulating the Kaaba naked, he would look down and he continued repeating the positive message, "Ayyuhan nas, O people, qulu la ilaha illallah tuflihu." Say la ilaha illallah, you will be successful. He kept on saying this, "O people, utter the shahada, you will be successful. O people, utter the shahada, you will be successful." Guess what happened? There were from amongst them people who uttered the shahada as a result of the constant effect, the constant statement, the beauty, the kindness. So many times the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam forgave. At Ta'if, if it was any one of us, I'm sure we would say, "Oh Allah, destroy this person. Oh Allah, destroy them." How many of us do make that dua against our brothers and sisters from one mother and one father? Because we are weak. We say, "Oh Allah, destroy him." A'udhu billah. The enemies of Ta'if, that did not happen to them. But we are doing it to our own brothers, our sisters, from one mother, one father, sometimes one family, sometimes one community, and sometimes from the ummah. We are quick to withdraw people from the ummah, throw them out and curse them completely. Why do we do this? Is that the prophetic way? Keep on asking yourself, when you hear people spew hate, is this the way of Rasulullah? Is this really the way of Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wasallam? As a Muslim, you will realize very quickly, no, it is not. It is not. He taught us love. He taught us kindness. He taught us when you have differences, you need to really respect one another and deal with it in the most positive way, in the most respectful way. And at times you may not be able to solve and resolve your matter. You still need to learn to respect one another. Let's listen to this verse. O people, ya ayyuhan nas, inna khalaqnakum min dhakarin wa untha. We have created all of you from one male, one female. Stop for a moment. That means you and I are brothers. Your forefather, my forefather was one person. We are related to each other. Almost all of us here are related to each other. A few generations down, not even too many, maybe 30, 40, 50 generations, we have one person who's a parent. And I'm honest with you. If you want to look and you want to search and you are a professional in DNA, etc., you can actually check it up. And you will find we are related. Guess what? Your great-great, you add a few more greats depending on how great it was. And you will actually get one person, subhanallah. And today we are killing each other, we are fighting each other, we are swearing each other. How? Allah is reminding you, O people, ya ayyuhan nas. It was enough for him to say, ayyuhan nas. O people, learn to know one another. But he did not say that. He says, O people, we created you from one male, one female. Why did he say that? For you to realize we are family. Wallahi, we are family. I promise, I swear by Allah that we are family. We are insan. We are called Banu Adam. If your father's name is Abdullahi, the children of Abdullahi are known as Banu Abdullah. The children of Abdul Muttalib are Banu Abdul Muttalib. The children of, for example, Abdul Bari are Banu Abdul Bari, for example. So the children of Adam are known as Banu Adam. Who is Banu Adam? You have to put your hand up and say, it was me. Am I right? You have to admit, I am Banu Adam. What about the man next to you? What about the man who is not a Muslim on the street? He's also Banu Adam. What about the children outside who do not believe in anything? They are also Banu Adam. What about those who are sinful? They are Banu Adam. I want to ask you, if your brother, your sister, from one mother, one father, or your son was sinful in his ways or habits or did something wrong, would you like that people kill him? Would you like that people harm him? Would you like that people insult him? Or would you like to see the matter resolved? Would you like to see him come forth and, for example, become better in his ways? When will a mother give up? A mother will never give up. She will continue praying, continue trying, continue having hope. Well, I tell you something, we too need to continue trying with one another because we are indeed brothers and sisters. We are indeed brothers and sisters. Now come the differences. So Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, "Inna khalaqnakum min dhakarin wa untha." We have created you from a single male and female. وَجَعَلْنَاكُمْ شُعُوبًا وَقَبَائِلًا لتعارفوا. And we have created you into various peoples and tribes, which means groupings. Your race is different. Your perhaps ethnicity is different. You come from different places. You have a different color. You are from a different tribe. You are from a different location. You look different to others. You go to Africa, you see people slightly darker in complexion. Some of the most amazing people. You go to Europe, you see people slightly fairer in complexion. Also, sometimes you will find amazing people. You come to this part of the world, you find the brown color. Subhanallah. Amazing people. You go, for example, to China, you can immediately recognize them. Amazing people. It does not mean they are bad. They are all Banu Adam. So why did Allah make us different? He answers the question for you. He says, لِتَعَارَفُ. One thing.
وَجَعَلْنَاكُمْ شُعُوبًا وَقَبَائِلَ لِتَعَارَفُ.
We have made you into different peoples and different tribes in order that you know one another. You recognize one another. Can you not recognize an African brother or sister who walks in? Must it make you hate them because of their complexion, for example? Never. If you do that, you are a person who has jahiliyyah or ignorance in him. You are wrong. You need to be corrected. The same applies. When you see a Caucasian, automatically you can recognize them. That's what Allah says. When you see a person from somewhere, you can recognize them because of the way they look, their habits, perhaps sometimes their culture. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala grant us a deep understanding. Ameen. So Allah says, we made you different for you to recognize one another. If you were all the same, you would not recognize each other. If everyone was the same, like a Toyota, for example, all the Corollas 1.6 are the same, what would happen? Life would be boring. We wouldn't have the Jaguars, we wouldn't have the Mercedes, we wouldn't have the Hyundais, we wouldn't have all these others. But Allah says to us, the example of man is higher, very high. We made you different so that you recognize each other. But Allah did not say, وَجَعَلْنَاكُمْ شُعُوبًا وَقَبَائِلًا أَسْتَغْفِرُ اللَّهِ لِتَقَاتَلُوا. Allah did not say that we made you peoples and tribes so that you can fight one another, so that you can kill one another, so that you can believe that you are superior to the other. Who is superior? Nobody is superior besides he who has piety. And piety is known by Allah. Piety is known by Allah alone. A man can have a beard reaching the ground. A sister can be covered as modest as ever. But the true condition of the heart is only known by Allah. Sometimes you can have a person who doesn't appear to be so religious, yet the condition of their heart is better than those sometimes who fulfill 5 salah a day, because Islam is not only about praying. Yes, praying is extremely important, but it is also about fulfilling the rights of the other creatures of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Remember this. When Allah created you, yes, He created you to worship Him alone. But with you, He created entire creation to test you. How are you going to treat them? That's all. Why did Allah make the snakes? Why did He make the crocodiles? Why did He make the pigeons and the parrots? Why did He make animals we love and some we don't? Why did He make people? Some we get along with them, some we don't. If Allah wanted, He could have taken their lives away. He can and He does. Because He is the giver of the life. He's also the taker of that life. So why do we then need to fight, hate, etc., so much negativity from us as Muslimin? For what? That needs to change, my brothers and sisters. Do you want to see a solution to the problems of the Ummah? We need to learn to worship Allah. And we need to learn to respect one another. And we need to understand, when we are different, it should not result in hatred amongst us or between us as human beings, but rather we understand each other. We differ with respect. That is something important. We differ with respect. We will discuss, brother, I think you are wrong. I think what you've said is wrong because of X, Y, and Z. And the brother will say, in fact, I think you are wrong because of A, B, and C. Okay, let's sit down. Let's try and see if we can come on common ground. If we cannot, still, you are my brother. Subhanallah. We differ in this matter. You are my brother. We get along, and we should be getting along with people of other faiths. We get along with, we should be getting along with people of other faiths. To be honest, the time of Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, there were Jewish people that they got along with. They were Christian people they got along with. They were people who were mushrikeen they got along with. Subhanallah, they did business with. And they were honest, upright. And in fact, they had dealings such that they got along so well, one would not have even told the difference. Doesn't it happen in our lives? All of us, we have people whom we interact with who are not Muslimin. We have so many differences, but we will still interact. Why? There is a lot of common ground. We are human beings. We are human beings. We need to build. We need to actually progress as human beings. But when the discussion of religion comes, you don't give up your faith in the same way that they may choose not to give up their faith. You can discuss it. You will continue being mature about it. You will be very respectful about it. You put forward what you believe. They will put forward what they believe. They know that this is the line. You don't expect them to come into the masjid, and they don't expect you to do something that is perhaps against what you believe. That is what life is. And that is what we live by. Yes, da'wah and propagation shall continue, but in a respectful way. Did the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam say, call towards Allah with hatred? Call towards Allah with fighting, with killing? No. In fact, he says, Allah says, subhanahu wa ta'ala,
ادعو إلى سبيل ربك بالحكمة والموعظة الحسنة وجادلهم بالتي هي أحسن.
Speaking of non-Muslims, Allah says, call towards the path of your Lord with wisdom. With wisdom and with beautiful reminders. With beautiful reminders. And when you are discussing the matters, give and take, then you need to use the best possible arguments. The best possible, the most respectful way. And you need to present that argument in a way that is convincing. At the end of the day, who is the guide? The guide is Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. What is your duty? Convey the message. I've conveyed it. Maybe after you die, they might accept Islam. They might not accept Islam, but maybe their enmity towards us might be reduced as a result of your goodness and your kindness as an ummah. I hope and I pray that these words that are prophetic, that have come from Allah and His Rasul sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, will help us as believers. I pray that we find the love in our hearts for one another with our differences. And I pray that we can embrace one another and we can learn to love each other. And we learn to identify hate mongers. And we learn really to convert that into love. I'm not saying that you need to love sinful behavior or you need to love something that is harmful, but I'm talking about the people. You need to ensure that you respect them. When someone has a bad habit, when someone has a sin, it is the sin that you're trying to eradicate, not the person. The mistake we make, we want to eradicate the person and the sin and everything, and 5 meters be in front of him and 5 meters behind him, and sometimes even more. That is very bad. It is very harmful. Remember, these words are golden, my brothers and sisters. We do not want to repeat the mistakes that have happened around us in our lives that have resulted in fighting and killing in an indiscriminate way. We need to do something about it. That is why I am speaking from this blessed, sacred pulpit in the house of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. To remind yourselves and myself, let us work on ourselves. Let us become better people. The heart needs to be filled with the remembrance of Allah, with the praise of Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam, and it needs to be filled with the love of the ummah. And the ummah is larger than you think it is. The ummah is larger than you think it is. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala bless us all. Aqulu qawli hadha wa astaghfirullah li wa lakum wa lisa'iril muslimin fastaghfiruhu innahu huwal ghafurur rahim.